Hey everyone, thanks for joining me today. Luke here. Today, this video is going to be about blending different string libraries. So we have Spitfire, Albion One, you have East-West Hollywood Strings, and East-West Symphonic Gold. And I created a mock-up of I'm Listening by James Newton Howard, which is a great, amazing piece. And yes, I did add strings to it. But it was a great little exercise with a really cool piano arrangement. And we're going to get into that. When I created the mock-up, I did start with the piano. Then I went to the middle strings and cello and the bass. And then I added the high strings. All right, so we're going to play the piece. And then we're going to look at the different instruments. And we're going to talk about how I tried to create a realistic sound for each of the string sections. And then we're going to talk about the reverb, which is the room that they were performed or recorded in. So we're going to talk about that today as well. So let's go ahead and play the piece so you can kind of get the feel of what I did on this mock-up. Here we go. Alright, so you can hear how all the strings are blended really well together, and I'm going to talk about how I did that. Once I get the part played or penciled in, yes, you can pencil things in, you don't have to play it in. Personally, I like to play them in, it keeps me connected to the piece, and it's fun. If I'm in a time crunch, sometimes I'll pencil stuff in and play it at the same time or back to back. Sometimes I'll alternate between them. And but in this case, I actually played them all in and then went back and did some manual adjustments. So once I get it in, then I'll go back and start looking at the dynamics and expression. So we'll take... Let's just take the middle strings, for example. So we'll zoom in here a little bit. And the dynamics are on the top. And then the expression is down here. And the way I like to do the dynamics is to ease into the note. So to kind of give that realistic feel, like somebody's actually bowing, you know, bowing on the instrument. Slowly kind of putting their finesse that the real player would put onto it. And then on the end of the note, I like to trail off just a little bit and then kind of come back into the next note. And I feel that adds a really cool sense of performance to the string section. And I do that on all the string sections. And then I do the same thing with expression. And I have it programmed in to be on one of the sliders of my M Audio Oxygen keyboard. And in contact, these are the different sections. So you have dynamics and expression. And of course, dynamics is on the top and expression. And so those two elements on each of the string sections. And I think it adds that sense of the realism for the strings. And you can hear, I'll play a little bit for you. It's just to the strings, so you can hear that. So you can hear how the notes kind of breathe a little bit, which I really like that. I think that sounds like a really cool performance, and it sounds more like a live orchestra. And that's one of the things I do a lot, is I listen to a lot of live orchestra recordings on YouTube and then match that with the dynamics and expression as best as I can in the computer. I mean, let's get real. Nothing's going to be better than a live player in a live orchestra. That's just the most beautiful thing on the planet. That's just my opinion. And we try to get as close as we can in the computer, and we can get pretty close, but, you know, still not the same as live. Live rocks. And so you can hear how that sounded really great. And so I'll do that also on, say, the cello, for example. We'll zoom back into the same kind of section. And then you can listen with the cello and the mid strings together. So you can hear how the cello and the strings in the midsection are still well balanced, and they kind of have the dynamics that complement each other. And some of this you have to do kind of based on ear and just a lot of, you know, kind of testing out what sounds great together. All the different string libraries, you know, the release times for the beginning of the note and the end of the note, they're not the same. And so if you go into, let's just say we'll take here, you can see over here a lot of the notes will be right on the grid. And then the beginning of the note's right on the grid. And then towards the end of the prior note, or the next note, you can see how I overlap. That's done on purpose. Sometimes I have it directly on the note. Sometimes it's overlapping. Depends on which library you're using, on how it triggers the legato. And you'll have to test this on all the different libraries. Sometimes you can put it just a touch into the next note and that triggers the legato. Sometimes you can actually quantize the beginning of the notes right on the grid. And then sometimes the ending of the note can be right on the next note, like I mentioned. Or sometimes you have to grab a bunch of them and then slide the ending of the note just a little bit into the next note to trigger the legato. And then Also, what I noticed to add to the blending and the realism of the east-west is that the beginning, where you put the beginning of the note, even if you don't do dynamics and expression, the actual sample is not triggered until sometimes a little bit into the note area itself. And so just be aware of that when you're blending string libraries as well. So all your notes from, say, Albion may not be exactly on the same spot on the grid as your notes from East West, but they sound like they're being played together. All right, then I focus on the placement of the instruments. For example, let's open up the contact for the high string. All right, so in the Albion One, you have mic position. You either do far or close or a lot of adjustments in between. So I kept it kind of in the middle because I felt like it blended with the east-west reverb environment a lot better, which we'll look at here shortly. So for the high strings and the mid strings, same placement. And then for the cello, number one, I use the Hollywood strings. See cello two, envy, envy, vibrato, round robin. Have the legato checked. And then I really like the way East West gives you an actual name for the recording location, which is also the reverb. And I find it really easy to, you know, match things up. There's no question on whether or not the slider, you know, on the mic position is in the exact same spot like in the Albion, which I love the Albion. And you kind of have to make sure that it's, you know, as close as you can get it. But with this one, you can actually just check the recording space that you want the instrument or the section to be in, and you're done. Now for the cello 2, that's just a copy of cello 1 in terms of the actual notes played and the instrumentation, but it is with the Albion 1, and you can see the mic placement is the same. I have it turned up a little bit because I want it to be a little bit more prominent in the mix. And then for the bass, see that this is the Symphonic Orchestra Gold package. And the Hollywood scoring stage is also selected, which this makes sense if you think about it. The live orchestra is recording together in the same place. Well, then you should put your orchestra in the same place, right? Right, makes sense. And when you're blending string libraries, you have to match that by listening to the libraries together, which is the next step. So let's do that. So let's do, actually, let's do the mid strings and the cello. And we'll just listen to see how they're blended together, since they're two different virtual instrument libraries. So you can hear how they're really well blended together. And remember, we've already got the dynamics and the expression set. So we've got those set. And then we've got the mic position or the reverb or the environment matched up. And then this is how you check not only your mix, but to make sure the environment sounds right together. You can always go back and adjust mic placement. And I will show you that real quick. If you move it closely, move the mic closer. You can see it's using more memory, right? You got to be careful of that, depending on your system. Now we'll just play it back with the mic closer. You can clearly hear the difference in the middle strings. And if you're not sure, tip of the day, if you're not sure where the default setting was for this particular library, you can hold down the control button if you're on PC and just double click. I'll do that. Watch this. Control, double click, and it snaps back. So that's a quick way to get back to default. But here's what it would sound like if you moved it to a far position. And again, back to where I had it before. So you can clearly hear the position difference versus far and close and in the middle. And so for this piece, I wanted the Albion strings in the middle because I feel like it blends better. Could be just my ears, but I think it sounds really great. All right, so moving along, the next thing that I did is that I continued to reference different sections together. So I did the mid strings, and then I'll do the low strings with the mid. So that sounds like it matches very well. And so then I'll go and I'll just pick another section and I'll do all sorts of different combinations of this as well. And then we'll pick a different section. Let's go with here. And as always, you can hear there's even room for improvement in the endings of some of those notes, which of course I will definitely go back and check that out. But you can hear how they're still balanced together. And so then we'll go and reference cello and cello, make sure those sound like they're in a great spot together. So you can see the different libraries are well balanced together because of all the adjustments that we've made prior to that. And then let's do the high strings, and then let's do kind of a little bit of a section here. High, mid, and cello. Thank you. had the middle strings stand out, just like intended, and they're blended well together. They sound like they're in the same recording place, same reverb, and then we'll do another section. Then we'll just add another section, a couple other sections, the second cello and then the bass. And then let's see what that sounds like. See how they sound together without the piano. So you can hear how the different sections are definitely balanced and blended together. Yep, there's still room for improvement, as always. But you can hear how they definitely sound like they're in the same location. And once I've done that and I get them blended, then I go in and I reference, you know, obviously the whole thing again. We'll do a small section. So to recap, when blending strings in a piece, you have the environment that they're being played in, which is also related to mic placement and reverb. And then you want to make sure that the dynamic and expression maps are programmed in a way that makes sense for the section, right? And then you want to reference what each section sounds like as a whole and as different groups, like with violin, the high strings, for example, with say the cello, or the mid strings with the cello, or mid strings with the bass with the high strings. So referencing those as small groups and then as the entire string group together, and then finally, referencing them with any other groups. And in this case, it's the piano group. So I hope that makes sense. This is kind of a quick blending lesson. And hopefully you learned something from it. And every time I do one of these videos, I always learn something as well. And so let's take a listen back through it one more time. So that's it for this video. Thanks for joining me. Look forward to seeing you next time. Don't forget to subscribe, and to get notified for the next video, just tap the little bell icon. Catch you later.